Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence. Let all the earth keep silence before him. Keep silence, keep silence before him.
Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Best place to be alive this morning is in the house of God. I won't be with you long today. But we will start off. First, let me say thank you for bearing with us on last week. We were out of town. I have my other kids. They stay in East Tennessee. So it's a long trip, coast to coast. And so we were there supporting my son and playing football now, high school football. And so I was promised them I'd be there on Monday, so I had to be there before that. So we're going to get started. I appreciate that. We'll start off with a hymn of praise this morning. As you think about what God has done for you,
amen.
Let's be alive and be thankful that we are alive. Amen?
Amen.
Because there's so many people who are suffering right now. So we want to ask God to change our hearts and our minds to be what he wants us to be. Amen?
Amen.
That's important. You have to change from within.
Change me, oh God. Make me more like you. Change me, oh God.
Yes.
Wash me through. Create me a clean heart so that I worship you. Change me, oh God. Make me more wash me through and through. Just create me a clean heart so that I may worship you. Change. I need you to wonderful change. Y'all remember this? Has come over me.
Shout over that, you ain't been changed, amen?
Amen.
Because when you've been changed, you don't care what somebody thinks around you. You don't care what somebody's saying on your job or whoever's or one of your friends. Oh, here he go. You know, you're not worried about those type of things. When God changes you, you're happy to be changed. You're not so dead, amen? Because when God changes, you go from death to life. Are you full of life this morning? That is the question. God has blessed us to wake up this morning and know who we are. Wake up next to the one you love and know that those around you are safe. Because God has given you the power, especially for us men, to protect our homes. It's a comforting feeling to know that my babies are laying in the bed just as safe as they can be. I think about that old Christmas carol when they say the children were nestled in their beds. Not a care in the world. Not a care in the world. That's a wonderful change. Because it didn't always be that way. Amen. Amen. It's now time for our morning prayer. You can prepare your mind thinking about what God has done for you. Again, as we always say, it's not always about asking God for something. Amen. But it's intercessory, praying for yourself, your soul, praying for those you love, praying that the Spirit will enter those who seem to be dead. Amen? So many people around us are dead. Dead in trespasses and sin, and have no wish to come out. Bible says, come out from among them. If you're going to follow God, you got to follow God. There is no in and out. Amen. No straddling of the things. So as we think about what's going on in the world and in our own families, in our own homes, we want to take this moment to talk to God. Heavenly Father, we come to you one more time saying thank you. Thank you for another beautiful day as the fall is entering in. The change that was prescribed by you, we see it all around us. Beautiful leaves are turning colors. Harvests are coming in. And if we sowed a spiritual seed, you are leaning in our direction right now. Lord, we thank you for our families. We thank you for our jobs. We thank you for the ability to know who we are. And after we know who we are, we have to know who you are. That our God is one God. And he loves us and take care of us. Thank you, Lord, for all the stuff that's going on in the world. Thank you for the healing that you have done with this coronavirus. Thank you for the peace that some people are trying to push in this moment of racial injustice. Lord, they always say history is doomed to repeat itself. And if we're not careful, Lord, we will go back into those gloomy days that we faced just 40, 50 years ago. Help us, Lord, to know that this country and this government is not God, and that you are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end of things. We thank you, Lord, for the family. We thank you for our spouses today. We thank you for the gift of the children that you have put in our possession. Help us to grow and nurture them and live lives that are an example for them. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your son. We thank you for the things and the words and the ways that he taught us how to live. And the way to be. Without this word, Lord, we would be lost. So we thank you for the light of your word to light up our path as we live in this moment of time. For our lives is just a moment in time. Help us to do what we're supposed to do. And if we don't know, Lord, give us the guidance to what it is I'm supposed to do in this life. For none of us are here in vain. We thank you for those who cannot get here today, but wish they could be here. Those that may be on their jobs right now. Those that may be going through a really rough time in life. Lord, let them know that this too shall pass. And for the ones who are coming out the storm, Lord, we thank you. We bless your holy name that we're still able to stand strong, knowing that you are in charge. We pray for our sick and our shut-in. Touch their bodies right now in the name of Jesus Christ. Take away the pain. Even if they never get up again, Lord, give them joy. Because joy is something the devil can't take from. He can take your walking, he can take our eating, he can take our thought pattern, but he can't take our joy. As long as you rest, rule, and abide in us, then we will do in you. This and many other things we pray and we say, amen, amen, and amen. Amen. The New Testament scripture today can be found in Mark chapter 10. Mark chapter 10, verses 7 through 9. And this will embark about what we're going to speak about today. Mark chapter 10, 7 says, "For this cause shall a man leave his father and his mother and cleave to his wife. And they twain shall be one flesh, so then that they are no more two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let not no man put asunder." It's now time for another song as we prepare to come to the altar after this song. Are you listening for what God is giving? Melodies that come from heaven. Every moment of your life. Your ears are closed from here. Here we go. Thank you, Lord.
Melodies from heaven. Rain down on me. Rain down on me. Melodies from heaven. Rain down on me. Rain down on me.
Take
me in your arms and hold me close. Rain down.
Yeah.
Rain down on me.
Feel
me. Feel me with the precious Holy Ghost.
Rain
down on me.
I'm feeling that, Vicky. Let me take it up here. Here we go.
It's now time for our altar call. You can come to the altar in your own way to let the Lord know how good he's been to you. And at the same time, what we do, you can bring your tithes and offerings at the same time, and we can collect them like that. Amen. What has God done for you? And just tell him thank you for being alive. No matter how old you are, how young you are, God has been good to you. He's been good to all of us. Amen. Announcements. I will say that we will be next Sunday again is first Sunday. Don't forget we will be doing communion with supper. I'm going to get a nice one of those nice good loaves of bread, not the slice, but the real bread loaf. And we will have just something small. It's not going to be a big major dinner. Just maybe some chicken tenders and some rice or something like that. Coleslaw. Whatever you guys want to do, that's fine. We can bring some things. We'll have our service. We will do the sacrament like we do and do the sacrament of the Holy Communion. We will have a light supper and then do the bread and the wine. God wants us to left on record the correct way to do things. And a lot of times we've let tradition rule the day. And the whole thing is that I speak and Lord wants us to do is come back. Come back to what the Bible says. It's laid out just for you everything you're supposed to do. And so we're going to try that on this next Sunday. So you all have my number. If you want, hey, I'll bring this or bring that. We don't have to have a meeting. You bring this, you bring that. Everybody knows that we're going to have it. And so bring something. Me and my wife will provide the meat, which will maybe be chicken tenders or something like that, and some corn or something like that, just something small. Somebody can bring some drinks, and we can do that. We'll have our communion, and then you'll be dismissed. Okay? Any other announcements? Yes, sir.
Yeah, I was
like, my family's over
the turkey, Bobby. And also, real
nephew, my stuff, Okay. This weekend,
that's
Let's pray for him. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We will definitely do that. What's his name?
Jeremy Bobby.
Jeremy Bobby. Make sure we keep Jeremy's name lifted up in prayer. And the family, so that God will bring peace, because losing a loved one is so very painful. And we will make sure we do keep him and the family and your family in our prayers. Amen. That's serious, especially in a time like this. Amen. All right. Yes, sir. Oh, yes, ma'am.
I just would like to be lifted in prayer myself. I had a job interview about a week and a half ago. I was supposed to hear news of got the job tomorrow. But if not, then if it's possible to give me another position that has the same hours so I can be at home with my family more. So I just ask for prayers for that.
Amen. Amen. Definitely keep that in prayer as well. Nothing like having Amen. All right. All right. Moving right along. We will go right on into the sermon. And the sermon today is called Two Flowers on the Same Stem. Two flowers on the same stem. This will go into how God intends us to be one flesh till death do us part. Matrimony and marriage are two different words. Amen. And the scripture will be, the sermonic text will be Matthew chapter 19, verses 1 through 9. Matthew chapter 19, verses 1 through 9, with a little background in Matthew chapter 1. 18 through 20. Again, we will subscribe to follow the text of the Bible. So God has a plan for us, amen? And it is to be together to death do us part. Matrimony is the state of or ceremony of being married. That is the holy part. When we go through the motions, amen, when we ask God and we use the text and the words of God to link us to one flesh. And then actual marriage is just a legal term showing that two have been married or have gone through the matrimony. Okay? Now, we will start out with Matthew chapter 19. Verses 1. And it came to pass that when Jesus had finished these sayings, he departed into Galilee. And he came to the coast of Judea beyond Jordan. And great multitudes followed him, and he healed them there. So Jesus is just off the crust of doing a lot of healing and miracles. Great multitudes have followed him. And you know that everywhere you go, when somebody is in a position of power, somebody wants to challenge that power. Somebody always comes out of the blue with some kind of off-the-cuff question to try to catch you slipping. And being flesh, a lot of times we don't catch that. A lot of times we answer before we think about it. And we think about it later on and say, you know what? I believe he was trying to catch me up. I wish I would have thought of that. I would have answered a little different. And so the Pharisees, who are always trying to catch Jesus, came to him tempting him. Verse 3 says, the Pharisees came to him, tempting him, and saying unto him, is it lawful for a man to put away his wife for every cause? And Jesus answered and said to them, have you not read? See, Jesus put it back to the scripture. Put it back to the law. They kicked the question to Jesus, and he kicked the ball back into their court to see if they have been reading. Have you not read that he which made them at the beginning of time, he made them male and female? At the beginning, amen. I'm talking about from the very beginning. God had made you male and female and said, for this cause, man shall leave father and mother and shall cleave to his wife, and they twain shall be one flesh. Hence, two flowers on the same stem. So, now that we are joined on one stem, that one stem has two separate flowers, amen? Each flower is its own flower, has its own amount of rose petals or whatever type of flower it is, has its own type, has its own hue. No two flowers are exactly the same, but yet they are linked together on one stem. And being on that one stem or the stalk, the stem is the support factor for the flowers. And the support factor gets its nourishment from God. The water and the sun and the breeze and the nutrients, all that comes from the ground, the roots of the flower. And that one stem, as the roots and the word and the truth and the life comes up that one stem, it is supplied to both flowers. If you cut one of the flowers off, it can never grow again. It will surely die. And so God is telling us that from the beginning of time, it was intended that you, man, would leave his mama and daddy and cleave to his wife and become one flesh, one stem, one light. Amen? And that light will be continuously supplied and taken care of and nurtured by one stem. Because God provides, amen? Every plant that's out there, the nourishments thereof come from the ground. Verse 6. So keeping that in mind. Verse 6 says, wherefore, they are no more two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let not no man tear asunder. So God is telling us, once you follow the steps of holy matrimony, and you become linked or twined in marriage, if God is at the head of that, no man can tear asunder. So here goes the trick. So then they waited on that answer. You know how people will bait you with one question because they really want to have the second question, but they'll bait you in with the first question and then hit you with that low blow. So saying all of that, they then said to him, well, why did Moses then command to give a writing of divorcement and to put her away? Oh, so now he's trying to, the Pharisees are trying to trick Jesus, saying, well, can a man put his wife away for anything? Then Jesus lets him know what the law was from the Alpha of times and what was intended to be for life. And then, so then they hit him with the other part. Well, then why did Moses say you can do it? Right? A lot of times we do this in life. My wife really hates it when she tells one of the kids to do something, they already done came to me. Didn't tell her that they already had come to me. And so they ask her something, and she'll say yes or no. And they say, well, Dad said it. So she's like, Dad said, you know, it kills her when they do that. And me too. So you know how that goes. The kids will play each other on each other, on you, right? And so they said, well, Moses said we could do it. And Moses was held of high esteem when it comes to the law, a Jewish custom and law. And so then, this is Jesus' answer. He said unto them in verse 8, Moses, because of the hardness of your hearts, suffered you to put away your wives, but from the beginning, it was not so. So he let them know that, yes, Moses allowed you to do it because your hearts were so hard against each other. He said, but from the beginning, that wasn't the intention. He didn't say it used to be this way, now it's this way. He said, from the beginning. He didn't say in the beginning it was like this, and now it's like that. Amen? He said, from the beginning. When you use the word from, you're intending to mean to this point today, right? From then to now. So he said, from the beginning, that was not so. Verse 9, and he said, I say unto you, here is the edict here. Who shall ever shall put away his life, except it be for fornication, and shall marry another, committeth adultery. And whoso marrieth her, which is put away, do committeth adultery. That, my brothers and sisters, is what was used for fuel to get divorced. Well, the Bible says, I can put away my wife, I can put away my husband if he commit adultery or for fornication, amen? So if I catch him doing this or catch her doing this, I can get divorced. But that is a misunderstanding of the text. You must look at the whole Bible in order to make it jive with each other. Because the Bible is not meant for confusion. God is not the author of confusion, and the Bible does not contradict itself. So let me give you an example. If you look at Matthew chapter 1, now at verse 18, now concerning the birth of Jesus and Mary and Joseph. See, this was a situation that they had, amen? And when Joseph found out that Mary was pregnant, he thought to put her away, amen? She was called his wife. He thought to put his wife away, but he was going to do it privately, not to shame her, right? Because he had love for her. And back then, a wife could be stoned to death for adultery. So instead of keeping her or having her to come to harm, he said, I will put away. He thought to put away his wife, right? Divorce his wife. But this is the understanding that's been misunderstood for so many years. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise. When as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, they, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. That's it right there. Mary was espoused to Joseph. They weren't married yet. But even though in the betrothal period, she was still considered his wife. And so, I go on, Joseph, her husband, being a just man, saying he was a good man and honest man and cared about Mary and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privately. Verse 20, but while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife. Fear not to take unto Mary thy wife. She was considered to be his wife in the betrothal period. And so don't be afraid and don't put away your wife, for which she is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. So I want you to understand, brothers and sisters, that in the betrothal period back then or now, the wife or the woman had the term or the title wife. And so what Jesus is saying later is that you can divorce or put away a wife in the betrothal period. Once you are betrothed and you find that that friend or that wife or that who you were going to marry has committed adultery or has cheated on you before the actual matrimony, then you can then put away that wife for fornication. That's what it's saying. Not once they become married. Once they become joined to one, they are one flesh, until death do you part. That is what God has intended. And so we get confused with saying, you can put away my wife. But the wife title is there in the engagement phase, the betrothal, the espousement. All those are the same term. And so when she was espoused to Joseph, she was already set to become his wife. They were only waiting on the actual marriage, right? It says, Mary was espoused to Joseph before they came together. And she was found to be with a child by the Holy Ghost. And so when we go back to the text that we're reading now, he says, number 9, back to chapter 19, verse 9, I say to you, whoever shall put away his wife except it be for fornication and marry another committeth adultery. What he's telling you is, in the betrothal period, that's considered to be your wife. Now, if she does something or he cheats in that period, you can put that one away. But if you go along and become physically joined or twined into one flesh, one stem, then those are to not to be divorced. Now, the question is, because this hurts. This hurts because if you are married to one and your first husband is still alive, then you are still bound to him until death. And that's the Bible. But the only question that you have to ask you, because it also says what God has joined together, let no man tear asunder. So the question is, did God put you together? Did God bring you two together? Because if God didn't do it, then he ain't in it. Amen? You know the ones that go to Las Vegas or someplace and mess around and get married, meet somebody, some stranger, and get married. God didn't put that together. You go to that 90-day fiancé stuff that they watch on TV, that I meet somebody in one day and tomorrow we're going to get married. God ain't in that. That's not holy matrimony. That's flesh. That's lust. That's ratings, right? That's what man wants to do. And so you have to understand, did God put this relationship together? And the only way, as my mom and I talked about, that you know that is for both of you to be grounded in the name of God. You both have to be evenly yoked. You won't know if that relationship was procured by God unless both of y'all are in the Word of God. You won't know if God brought y'all together unless you both are pulling from the substance of the same God. That's when you know this person is for you. Amen? It's not a 5-day, 2 weeks, we get married. Right? That's lust. So a lot of people get married for the wrong reasons. If you got married for the wrong reasons, God ain't in that. Oh, he got money. Girl, I'm about to go on and marry him because he got money. He rich. We're going to get married. God ain't in that. Or she looks so good, I'm going to go on and marry her. Because we know God says that money and looks will fade over time. Only what God has put in your life will stand forever. And his word shall live and stand forever. And if his word is in your spouse, then that marriage shall stand forever. Until death do you part. So don't get that misunderstood. Because a lot of people will throw that scripture in your face and say, well, Jesus said, whoever put away his wife except for fornication. But what he's saying is when you put her away, if you can put her away in the betrothal period, during the engagement, because back then the engagement was a big to do. When families put families together and say, you're going to marry her, right? And there was an engagement period. Well, in that period, if something was to happen or one of the other cheats on you, then you can put that one away. But if you become and you go on with it and become married and become one still, then there is no living without. There is no separation of the flowers. Two flowers will remain on the same stem for the rest of one of y'all's life. Amen. Because somebody gonna die first. And so we got to understand that that's very important to understand, and that our young girls and boys, take your time before you choose a mate. Take your time and make sure you have vetted them in the Word of God. Not what somebody else said, or not what your girlfriends and them say, or what everybody else, just because he's popular, or he got money, or she's real beautiful, or she's got money. That's not what brings us together. The Word of God is what brings you together. Amen? And so if you are deciding on a mate, take your time so that you don't make this mistake. Because once you make it, you are bound until he dies. Or you are bound until she dies. That's important to understand, brothers and sisters. Because we are two flowers on the same stem. And only when you do things the right way will they last. Amen? Anytime you go against the Word of God, anytime you go against the structure of God, you have problems. It never goes right. Amen? You don't see the sun trying to be the moon. You don't see the moon trying to be the sun. Dogs ain't trying to be cats, and apples don't wish to be oranges. Everything on this world has an order. And God has prescribed his order in the Word of God. And you have to have somebody who can divine the words to give them to you so you can understand. And the only way you can understand once you get the word is to have a relationship with God. Because he will give you the discernment of what's being told. Amen? So when you hear a lie, you know a lie. When you see a lie, you know a lie. You get a vibe from somebody. Something ain't right about this person. But you won't know that because when you meet somebody, you meet their representative. You don't meet them. You don't meet them until about a year or so. Amen? That's when the real one come out. But when you first meet somebody online or at school or at the grocery, that's their representative. They would never let you see them real person, not till a little bit later. And then if the real person is not very deep into the Word of God, don't force it. Because what God puts together, no man can tear asunder. But what you put together will fade as quick as you can blink your eyes. What you try to put together won't last but a hot minute. Because those looks or those reasons that you got married, you'll look around and say, why did we get married? It ain't even here no chance. He done gained all this weight. I don't even have an eye for him no more, right? But if God put you together, it don't matter how you look. It don't matter what you go through in life. God will still have that strong love between them two flowers. You will still pull on that stem of God, getting the same nutrients, the same water, the same word, the same light, happiness, and bitterness. Amen? We go through ups, and it goes through downs, but the flowers bloom together into death. To God comes and pulls you up out the ground and takes you with him. Then you have eternal life with God. Two flowers on the same stem. Don't make that mistake. Take your time because it ain't going nowhere. And anything or anybody that's rushing you on to marry, that ain't of God. Be leery of that because that's not God. And if God has put you together, and you in a relationship or marriage, and God has put you together, then stick tight with each other. Understand that we're going to go through ups and downs. I don't care if it's been 30 years. You do 30 more. And after them 60, you do 30 more. Until God takes one of you away. Because true love will always be there. You can't even mention my daddy's name without my mama tearing up. My daddy been dead for 20 years, 25 years. You can't even mention his name without her crying. And if you got that type of love for somebody, That's what God put with you. That's what God has intended for you. And you need to stay with them through the ups and downs, sickness and health, for better, for worse. To death do you part. Because you are two flowers on the same stem. Amen. Amen. Can you stand as we open the doors of the church? But we have one that may want to come for special prayer, one that just want to come and have extra prayer, or we have one that comes into those doors at any time. The doors of the church are open. Just like we open the doors of the church, you need to open up your mind and your heart for the true word of God, not traditions. Amen? Just because you thought it was the way, when the truth comes and hits you hard, it hits me just as hard as it hit anybody else. But that don't mean I have to skip it. Amen? I have to talk about it. I have to teach that word, whether it hurts me or not. This is a book of pain. No man would have written a book that is so much against his own flesh. If man would have wrote this for man, it would have been nothing in here that hurts you. But because God's word is inspired in here, it hurts you and it makes you feel good all at the same time. It helps us to get right. Doors of the church are open. You may be seated. Young folks, take your time. Even when parents are dead and gone, take your time. Let God choose your mate. But you won't know unless you are in the Word yourself. There's no way to defeat the devil on your own. He knows too much about you, amen? He knows what you like. He knows what would float your boat. He knows what would get you to own this side. You got to have God in your corner, guiding you for your life. But this is a decision you're going to make for the rest of your life. Nothing to play with. Amen? Amen. Right. This time we can stand for the doxology. Be ready to go. Praise God. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. For the benediction. Now to Him who was able to keep you from falling, to Him whose word we want to follow, help us, Lord, to understand better what you want us to do. Help us to understand that we need to make time to learn you. And these lives are so busy. All of us have so much to do. So many things going on. Our attention is being distracted in every direction but to you. Lord, help us to drown out everything else in our lives and to focus on you. Because you said if we seek first the kingdom of God, then all this outside stuff will be given to us. But not vice versa. Be with us as we leave this place. Keep us safe. Protect our bodies from this coronavirus and any other bug that comes around. Protect us. And protect mostly our soul. For we want to go with you, Lord, when you return. This and many other blessings we pray for. And the people say, amen. 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 We'll see y'all next Sunday.